Hi, I'm Trent Musho, and this is The Brew Show. In today's video, I'm going to show you the ins and outs of brewing your own beer at home. You might think brewing beer could be complicated, but I'm here to make it as easy as possible. Today, I'll walk you through a sample brew day, calling out terms and processes you should know, as well as equipment to get you started. Brewing beer is cost-effective, a fun hobby, and what tastes better than something you made yourself? Let's jump into it. First, let's talk about fermentation. Without it, we wouldn't be enjoying all our favorites, like beer, wine, and hard cider. Fermentation is a process that happens when you add yeast into a sugary substance, like wort with making beer, or grape must when making wine. The yeast then converts the sugars into alcohol. Next, let's talk about the four basic ingredients that make up beer: water, malt, hops, and yeast. Water accounts for 90% of beer. A good rule of thumb is that if you like the way your water tastes, then it should be good to brew it. There are various water adjustments you can make to improve the flavor, however, those are not mandatory, especially if you're just starting out. Malt provides the source of sugar for the yeast to ferment. Some examples of this would be barley, wheat, rye, or even rice. Hops are the bittering component of the beer. These are used to add flavor and aroma. It also balances out the sweetness of the malt. Yeast is a microorganism that converts the sugars from the malt into alcohol and carbon dioxide, thus allowing us to get our drink on. For each item I'm about to discuss, you can take a look at the description box below, and I'll have links to the products for easy reference. You can also find any of these items at your local or online home brewing store. I enjoy brewing outdoors on a propane burner because I like being outside, and I tend to make a bit of a mess. Feel free to brew in your own kitchen. Alright, now let's get into the brewing. First, it's time to heat up the water in a kettle. The size of the kettle you will need is dependent on the amount of beer you're trying to make. I normally make 5.5 gallon batches, and for that I use an 8 gallon kettle. A deep frying kettle would also work perfectly. If you want to start by brewing a smaller batch, no worries, just use the largest stock pot you have at home. Next, let's talk about mashing. Mashing is the process of steeping the grains in hot water to extract the sugars within the grain to create what is called wort. Wort is the unfermented beer. It contains the sugars needed for fermentation. There are three ways to mash: extract, all grain, and partial mash. Extracts can either come in dry form or liquid form. You just add water to create an instant wort. This is the easiest for a beginner as there's less equipment needed. Extracts are a set mix of malts, but the next methods allow you to be a little more creative. All grain. This technique uses the raw ingredient of grain. This allows for more control over the final product because you're picking out each grain. You can fine-tune or experiment with recipes as opposed to the extract. This involves needing some additional equipment to soak the grains. There are many ways to do an all-grain mash, but I prefer the brew-in-a-bag method. This is when you add the grains to a mesh bag and you make a malt tea. Of all these methods, this might be the easiest way to get into all-grain. Partial mash is a combination of the previous two methods. For this, you use an extract and then a few specialty grains that you do a mini-mash with and add to the wort. There's not much more equipment needed for this compared to extract, and you can make a big impact on the final flavor of the beer. Let me know in the comments which style of mashing you think you'll go for on your first brew day. Typically, we mash between 145 to 158 degrees Fahrenheit. Mashing on the high end of that range helps accentuate mouthfeel and body, while mashing at the low end of that spectrum extracts more fermentable sugars, leading to a higher alcohol percentage. Once the water is warmed up, we add the grain bag. If you're doing an extract batch, no bag is needed. You can just add the malt to hot water and mix. We then add the grains to the bag and prepare to steep them for 45 minutes or so, holding the temperature within that 145 to 158 Fahrenheit range. Once the mash is complete, we pull the grain bag and we dispose of the grains. I like to compost mine. No matter which method of mashing you choose, it's now time to boil the liquid. This is done to concentrate the wort, kill any existing bacteria or wild yeast, and to extract flavor from the hops and other ingredients. Hops are a plant that are grown on a vine, and you can use the whole leaf or pellets. Boiling the hops for different amounts of time impacts what is pulled out of the hops. The longer you boil, the more bitterness you extract. The shorter you boil, the more aroma and flavor you take from the hops. Each variety of hops have a different flavor. Some have a more sharp flavor, while others are more floral. This is a fun area to experiment with and try something new. We now stop the boil and cool down the wort. This can be done by sticking your kettle in an ice bath. You can also use a wort chiller or a plate chiller. These instruments help cool your wort down faster by circulating cold water through either copper tubing or a small plate. I made my own wort chiller from supplies I got at a local hardware store. The wort needs to be cooled down to fermentation temperature so the yeast can perform. If the wort is too hot, you'll kill the yeast. The next piece of equipment you'll need is a food-safe sanitizer. This is very important. When brewing, you need to ensure every item that comes in contact with your wort and beer is sanitized. This helps control the wild bacteria and yeast that might infect your beer, causing it to spoil or taste funky. No bueno. Do not skip this vital product. I like to use a spray bottle for ease of use. Once the wort is cooled down, we can now transfer it into a fermentation vessel. You will need a container to store it in while it ferments. There's a lot of options for fermenters, such as buckets, carboys, either plastic or glass, conicals, and stainless. I use a BPA-free, food-safe plastic carboy. I like the one I have because it's clear, so I can easily check in on the beer. It also has a large opening at the top, which makes it easy to clean. The most inexpensive option would be a food-grade safe bucket, which is what I used when I got started. Another helpful tool is a refractometer or hydrometer. These tools are used so we know how fermentable the wort is, and so we can tell when the beer is done fermenting, as well as the final alcohol percentage. The hydrometer does this by placing it into the liquid, and it will rise or fall depending on the density of the liquid. For the refractometer, you place a few small drops of the liquid on the plate and you look through the eyepiece to read the measurement. Both of these are on a scale of specific gravity points, or bricks. The more sugars, the higher the number. If you don't have this tool, you can still make beer, but you won't know exactly how strong it is. Now, we add the yeast. The yeast comes in many different styles and forms, depending on the beer you want to make. The two main categories are ales and lagers. Ales are the easiest kind of beer to start with, since they like to be fermented around room temperature, whereas lagers like to be fermented at lower temperatures, so you'll need to monitor the temperature more closely. Another helpful tool to go with your fermenter is an airlock and stopper. The airlock is a device that allows carbon dioxide to escape the fermentation vessel without letting anything in. We need to let the carbon dioxide out, or else the pressure in the container will increase so much it can actually explode. As long as you have an airlock, you do not need to worry about such explosions. It's also helpful to have an airlock so you can see the fermentation activity, and when it stops bubbling, you know the fermentation is almost complete. If you don't have an airlock, just use a piece of tin foil. I used this technique in my previous hibiscus saison video. If you missed it, check it out, it's linked below. Now place your fermenter in a cool, dark place. Ales like to ferment around room temperature, and typically ferment in 5 to 7 days. Recipes will usually tell you what specific gravity your beer will have when the fermentation is complete. You can also tell when fermentation is complete when the airlock bubbling slows down. Once fermentation has ended, we'll need a way to get the beer out of the fermenter. Some fermentation buckets come with a spigot that allows you to transfer to bottles or a keg. If you're using a carboy or standard food safe bucket, an auto siphon and some liquid tubing makes this easy. The lowest cost option would be to save beer bottles you have used. You will need to buy bottle caps, which are very inexpensive, and a capper, which isn't too pricey either. You could use flip-top bottles, so you don't have to cap them, but just make sure that you use fermentation-grade bottles that can hold pressure. Do not use decorative bottles. They will explode. Remember to wash your bottles out with the previously discussed food-safe sanitizer before bottling. If there's anything left in the bottle, it could impact both the flavor and carbonation of your beer. This is a good time to have a helper. Maybe entice them with taking home a couple of delicious home brews. Fill them up with your siphon, add the appropriate amount of sugar based on your calculations, and top away. The reason we add sugar to the bottles is to give the remaining yeast something to chew on and create more carbon dioxide in the bottles, aka bubbles. It's important not to overdo it on the sugar, or you could have an explosion on your hands. I have linked below to a great online calculator, which shows how much sugar you should be adding while bottling. The beer will need to sit in a cool, dark place for about 2 weeks until the bottles have reached peak carbonation. Kegging makes things easy, as you only have to transfer the beer from the fermenter once. It also carbonates faster than bottling, because it uses forced carbonation via a CO2 tank, so you will not need to add any additional sugar to create carbonation. This is the option I currently use. Once the beer is ready, I pour it into a keg, close it up, connect the CO2 tank, and apply the desired PSI. After about 1 week, it's ready to drink. I have a kegerator, which is essentially a mini fridge converted to serve beer, with a tap at the top and a keg and CO2 tank in the fridge. There are a few additional things you might need to help with cleanup. Having a longer or stiff bristle brush will help you clean out the sediment and fermentation residue from the fermenter. Brew Cleaner is designed to specifically remove beer residue. Again, not mandatory, but highly recommended. I also want to mention kits. If you're looking for a simple way to brew, kits can be found online or at your local brew supply store with everything you need to get started. They will often include ingredients you need, beginner equipment, and instructions. Some mistakes and things to avoid. Once fermentation has begun, it's important to keep beer out of direct, bright light, as this will oxidize or skunk your beer. Oxygen is important for the yeast to perform its job. However, once the yeasts are in full swing of fermentation, it's important to avoid oxygen in all steps moving forward. This is because it will oxidize your beer as well, causing off flavors. So be careful not to splash your beer on too much, especially during bottling. I know this was a lot of information, but remember, homebrewing should be fun. Experiment with flavors. Find recipes of your favorite beers you like to enjoy. Or try some of the recipes I'll be posting. Is there a specific beer you want to see me make? Let me know in the comments below. Brewing your own beer can be very cost effective. It's a great way to be more self-sufficient. If something does not come out exactly as you plan, learn from your mistakes. You always pass failure on your way to success. If you have any questions, be sure to drop them in the comments and I'll do my best to answer them. Please subscribe if you want to learn more about how to easily brew your own beer. Thank you for watching and happy brewing!